You're watching Tag TV. You're watching Tag TV.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with Pakistan, where it seems that everybody except the Punjabi elite is enduring subjugation. Whether it is the religious minorities or the ethnic ones, Islamabad has launched a sweeping crackdown against everybody it doesn't like. In this self-proclaimed democratic state, even a peaceful dissent is not allowed, and this is the reason now victims are going global to express their plights. Pashtun activists recently held a protest outside the UN office to highlight ongoing human rights violations by the Pakistan Army and intelligence agencies. They expressed concerns over targeting of ethnic Pashtuns in so-called military operations against terrorism. A report.
A number of activists from Pashtun Tahafuz movement gathered outside United Nations in Geneva to protest against Pakistan Army and other state agencies. These activists, who had come from across Europe, expressed their concerns over ongoing human rights violations in Pakistan's Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and federally administered tribal areas of Fatah. They blame that hundreds of Pashtuns were still missing while many others had been killed in the so-called anti-terrorist military operations of Pakistan Army. They also said that Pashtun-dominated areas were rapidly losing the count of their population. They highlighted innocent Pashtuns have been targets of military operations, ethnic stereotyping and abductions by the Pakistani security forces for past several years.
We demand from the international community to look into this matter and establish or make an international inquiry commission on what has happened in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and Fatah in the last 17 years. Everybody knows that Pashtuns have been killed massively in this area. According to estimates, 75,000 Pashtuns have been killed.
The North and South Waziristan areas of Fatah were the site of large military operations in 2009 and 2014 after the Pakistan Taliban took control of swathes of territory in the region. Waziristan is still affected by media restrictions, limiting the ability of journalists to travel there, and activists say that has contributed to portrayal of the Pashtun population as we did to backward tribal customs and maintaining close ties to militant groups. In 2014, Pakistan Army launched Operation Zarb-e-Azb in North Waziristan after six gunmen affiliated with Tehreek-e-Taliban conducted a terrorist attack on the Army Public School in Peshawar City.
That would damage our culture, that would damage our language, and so many things are happening to destroy Pashtun and damage Pashtuns. So that is the reason that Pashtun are feeling it, they are resisting it, and they are raising their voice.
The PDM activists also launched a poster campaign outside the UN office and have been highlighting the issue on social media under hashtag Stop Pashtun Genocide. Of late, a grassroots movement known as the Pashtun Tahafuz Movement has emerged to champion various human rights issues, including the alleged disappearances of over 32,000 people in Pashtun-majority areas bordering Afghanistan, where Pakistani forces and the Taliban continue to clash. Pashtun Tahfuz movement emerged after the killing by police of Pashtun youth Nakibullah Mehsood in Karachi sparked a nationwide condemnation and demonstrations, attracting several thousand people. Mass rallies organized by PTM have been suppressed in the media, while PTM organizers themselves have been subjected to intimidation and abductions.
Moving on to Afghanistan, which has been rocked by nearly daily bombings of Taliban. The militant group, which is said to have been rattled by US President Donald Trump's decision of peace talks cancellation, has also vowed to disrupt the elections that are scheduled for 28th of this month. The Taliban message became clear when they attacked an election rally of Afghan President Ashraf Ghani. The president, who has been rooting for sustained democracy in the state, termed the explosions an act of cowardice. Meanwhile, the civilians whom the Taliban had committed not to harm have found themselves at the center of the sufferings and losses.
More than 100 people, including a large number of civilians, have already been killed in what could be termed as the beginning of a new wave of Taliban violence in war-torn Afghanistan. And this time, the attacks are not restricted to the capital and the region around, but all across the country. There are two motivations for Taliban. It doesn't want a democratic exercise of elections to materialize, and others, they are feeling betrayed by the sudden demise of the peace talks that had earlier given them a hope of returning to the power. There has also been witnessed a change in the modus operandi and the targets of the Taliban. Earlier, while they were cautious about targeting the innocent civilians, there are no such principles being followed in this rampage. In fact, civilians have borne the major brunt of the attacks. And as usual, the corps are mere messengers of the sad news and statistics.
حین رفتن مردم داخل رفتن داخل کمپ و موترسکیل کی که شما عملا جسدش میبینید که یک سفید است ریش شمزرد و ای آمد است و به سرعت هم یه سرک و میخواد فجار ده که در قسمت تلفاتش
The insurgents who have sworn to violently disrupt the vote attack a rally of Ashraf Ghani, whom they see as a chief enemy. Earlier, they had not allowed his participation in the peace process despite the efforts of the United States. The leader may have remained unhurt, but it clearly reflects the potential of the Taliban. The Afghan leadership, which has past accused Pakistan of financing the insurgents, has called Taliban cowards. However, the Kaman people are still saying that it is Pakistan fomenting troubles in their country.
ملکی کسان تر پاسه و ډیر زخمیان شهیدان لرو یو هم د لټی کس نسته بخښه سره کلاس یو د شفخانه ساتون کې زخمی ته سچې زخمی ده نو ټول ملکی خلک شهیدان دي دا 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 د پنجاب هغه کرګړن د ساده د پنجاب دا دا د پنجابیانو د ساده د زموږ د وطن د ازلي دښمنان دي
Meanwhile, Pakistani Prime Minister Imran Khan, who was once infamous as Taliban Khan, in a desperate attempt to regain his lost reputation, called for the resumption of the peace talks between Taliban and the United States. In yet another act of drama, he even said that he had no idea about the development of the talks, else he would have interfered.
हम यहां तक गए हमने कहा कि पीस टॉक्स में पाकिस्तान नहीं बैठा ये सिर्फ तालिबान बैठे और अमेरिकन्स के बीच में हमने बीच में कोई शिरकत नहीं की लिहाजा हमें तो नहीं पता था कि टॉक्स किधर तक पहुंची हैं और अगर हमें पता होता कि किधर रुकावट आ रही है तो शायद पाकिस्तान और अपनी कोशिश करता लेकिन क्योंकि हमें पता ही नहीं था और बिल्कुल आपने ठीक कहा इस्माइल के हमें एकदम हमने तो अखबारों में पढ़ा कि वो टॉक्स ब्रेक डाउन की है मैं समझता हूं कि ये बहुत बड़ी ट्रेजेडी होगी कि अगर ये ट्रॉक्स आगे ना बढ़ी मेरी मंडे को प्रेसिडेंट ट्रंप के साथ मीटिंग है न्यूयॉर्क के अंदर. मैं पूरा उनको इंसिस्ट करेंगे कि ये इस वक्त सबसे पहले तो चार डेकेड से यानी 40 साल से अफगानिस्तान के लोग इस वक्त इस इंतजार में फंसे हुए हैं और बहुत तबाही मची हुई है. तो पहले तो अफगानिस्तान के लिए बड़ा इंपॉर्टेंट है टॉक्स हो.
World leaders might come up with the different speeches and rhetoric, but it is the Afghans who are suffering. It is the Afghans who are declining in number with every rising sun. Today, the country is on high alert in the days approaching the election. The fourth presidential poll since United States-led forces toppled the hardline Islamist Taliban in 2001. Roughly 9.6 million people, about a third of them women, have registered to vote, but roughly 1 in 12 polling centers may not open because of security threats. And the manner in which Taliban have upped their offensive, it remains to be seen how the action day actually unfolds.
We are now joined by Dipankar Sen Gupta, a geopolitical expert who has been closely following the developments in Afghanistan. Mr. Dipankar, more than 100 people have been killed in the multiple explosions carried out by Taliban in just 1 week. How do you see this upped offensive of the militants?
I see is that as a continuation of Taliban tactics ever since 2001 or rather 2003, when the Taliban, after being turfed out of power, following the New York attacks of 2001, started to come back and started to take on the Afghan government. So I see no continuation in the Taliban tactics so far. The Taliban has always relied on a mix of tactics. One is basically to take on the Afghan armed forces. The other largely has been to indulge in hit and run tactics, terrorist tactics, where it doesn't matter the extent of collateral damage that takes place in the form of civilians getting killed or policemen getting killed.
Moving on, Pakistan's atrocities at people it has occupied for more than 7 decades were exposed in an event held on margins of 42nd session of United Nations Human Rights Council. The activists from Pakistan's illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan lambasted Islamabad's double standards and called themselves citizen of India. They also urged New Delhi to initiate the process of integrating the region with India.
Pakistan's double standards at global platform were exposed when a conference held on the sidelines of the 42nd session of United Nations Human Rights Council apprised media and audience of the status quo of the region. Various exiled Gilgit-Baltistan leaders living in different parts of the globe gathered to educate people about the massive human rights violations being carried out with impunity by army and other state agencies of Pakistan. Activists accused Pakistan of illegally occupying the region for 7 decades and misruling the people through different ways and means. They said the human rights situation in Gilgit-Baltistan was grim and was constantly deteriorating with time. They, however, expressed their happiness with the decision of the Indian government, who they said was truly working in the welfare of the citizens of Jammu and Kashmir, unlike Pakistan, whose words were shallow and sympathy was synthetic. They categorically said that Gilgit-Baltistan was an integral part of India and deserved to be governed by New Delhi. These activists, who have earlier demanded reserved seats for Gilgit-Baltistan in Indian Parliament, urged New Delhi to step up its diplomacy in order to liberate the region from Pakistani clutches.
It is time for India, which is the lawful, legal owner of Gilgit-Baltistan, to step up in the United Nations and outside the United Nations, claiming Gilgit-Baltistan, not just with symbolic gestures, but building relationship with the people of Gilgit-Baltistan. Because what we have seen, that what India has done in Ladakh by giving them autonomy right now, giving them their own union territory, is something that we could look towards and hope that one day Gilgit-Baltistan will also be able to have that kind of development and political model that India provides to Ladakh.
Since 1947, Gilgit-Baltistan has been ruled with an iron fist by Pakistani authorities. People of the region have no say in the laws that are formed to govern the region. They have no representation in the Parliament of Pakistan. Police and policies are used as instruments of suppression by Islamabad. Anti-Terrorism Act is widely misused to stifle the voice of demands and dissent. There have been numerous cases where the activists have been jailed and tortured. In other cases, they have even been hacked to death. People of the region have maintained that their region is an extended part of Indian Union territory of Ladakh and deserve the treatment and development like that only. Activists said that it was high time when United Nations took note of the situation and acted against Pakistan for illegally occupying the region.
India and Gilgit-Baltistan are part of the same body, part of the same culture and civilization, and part of the same country. And I think the United Nations, the member of the United Nations, need to realize that Pakistan has become a big stumble block for the last 70 years, and it is the only reason why there's a huge impasse in achieving the real development and real true autonomy that the people of Gilgit-Baltistan deserve within the Indian Constitution.
Pakistan has also allowed Chinese to settle in GB on the pretext of the China-Pakistan economic corridor. This has triggered a massive demographic shift in the region, compelling people to demonstrate and protest for their rights. But they have gained little or no success inside the boundaries of Gilgit-Baltistan, where the local population has been outnumbered by troops stationed permanently to keep a vigil on them. The activists, however, are determined, and they say the fight will continue until Pakistani shackles are broken from Gilgit-Baltistan.
Moving on. Defeats after defeats, Pakistan is seemingly going through a phase of diplomatic defeats and embarrassments. Whether it is its own sovereign territory or the floor of the United Nations, the country has become a laughing stock. Its leadership has been desperately seeking global attention by raking up Kashmir, but has been snubbed by all, including the Islamic countries that it was counting upon. Meanwhile, India, which took a historic step of mainstreaming Kashmir by providing it the status of the rest of the country enjoys, has said that Pakistan-occupied Kashmir will also be a part of it. A report.
Indian Foreign Minister believes that New Delhi will gain physical control over Pakistan-occupied Kashmir in coming times. The statement comes in line with Indian efforts to mainstream Jammu and Kashmir just like the other states of Indian Republic. Only last month did India abrogate the Article 370, which ensured a special status to the region but kept it isolated and away from the people of the country.
POK, yes, our position on POK has always been and will always be very clear. POK is part of India, and we expect one day that it will we will have the jurisdiction, physical jurisdiction over it.
Meanwhile, Pakistan failed to file a request for a resolution on Kashmir United Nations Human Rights Council after it failed to gather even the minimum numbers required for a resolution to be admitted in the council. The rule demands at least 15 people to be in support of the proposer of the resolution. The country made tall claims of having support of dozens of member states. The biggest setback for the country was that even Organization for Islamic Cooperation, which on its own strength of 15 members could have got the job done, did not support Pakistan. It is a clear indication of how seriously Pakistan is taken in the international arena. While Pakistan has been making all-out efforts to say that Kashmir is an international issue, global community have time and again suggested with their actions that it is India's exclusive and internal issue. Earlier, the Foreign Minister of India had clearly said that Pakistan was peddling a narrative on an issue which was totally New Delhi's prerogative.
First of all, 370 is not a bilateral issue. 370 is an internal issue. Now, with regard to Pakistan, the issue is not 370. The issue is Pakistan's terrorism.
Pakistani Prime Minister says that he will raise Kashmir issue in the United Nations General Assembly, but keeping in view the conditions developing around the issue, it looks highly likely that Pakistan will amend its script for the occasion. The frustration is already palpable with it denying Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi's plane the usage of airspace to travel to the United States. It has already been issuing hollow threats ever since the UNHRC session began in Geneva. While its foreign minister threatened with genocides in Kashmir, Prime Minister Imran Khan has gone a step ahead with the threats of a nuclear war. India has, however, paid no heed to its rhetoric. It gave a befitting reply to Pakistan in the UNHRC and is ready to counter in the General Assembly as well.
Moving on to India, whose Union Territory Ladakh recently hosted the most awaited Naropa Festival. Popularly known as the Kumbh of Himalayas, the festival witnesses the presence of thousands of people who gather at the famous Hemis Monastery in Leh's Naro Phodang to celebrate the life of a great Buddhist philosopher and teacher, Naropa. Have a look.
Set against the backdrop of the glorious mountain of Ladakh, the Naropa festival draws every visitor to the land of passes to experience its rich culture and heritage. Initiated in 2016 by Drukpa Rinpoche at Hemis Monastery, the five-day festival is a vibrant mix of traditional and contemporary events. This year, the festival commenced with the hoisting of National Tricolour by Junior Finance Minister Anurag Thakur, the chief guest of the occasion. Centered on the theme of environment sustainability of Ladakh and Himalayan region, the festival gave a strong message to the world on banning single-use plastic.
ये फेस्टिवल जो है बहुत ही यूनिक है इस साल तो और भी ज़्यादा यूनिक है क्योंकि हम पूरा ऑर्गेनाइजिंग कमेटी और लद्दाखवासी जो लद्दाख को यूनियन टेरिटरी स्टेटस जो ग्रहण करा है गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया की ओर से और इसको हम सबसे पहले सेलिब्रेट कर रहे हैं साथ साथ में इस फेस्टिवल में बहुत सारे सांस्कृतिक प्रोग्राम कल्चरल प्रोग्राम और साथ में हम कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि ये पूरा फेस्टिवल जो है पाँच दिन चलेगा और ये पूरा ज़ीरो वेस्ट काइंड ऑफ फेस्टिवल होगा साथ में हम जेंडर इक्वालिटी के बारे में बहुत सारे एक्टिविटीज़ है इन्वायरमेंट के बारे में बहुत सारे एक्टिविटीज़ है
The Naropa events bring together the largest assembly of Drukpa masters and include cultural performances by prominent Himalayan artists representing the greater Drukpa community. Aimed at providing platform to the young Ladakhi artists, this year the festival presented a number of singing and dance performances that were soaked in the spirit of patriotism.
The festival is also an opportunity for the entire Ladakh to come together, celebrate, rejoice, and also for the Ladakhi artists to perform on such a majestic stage. So this year we are aiming for 500 participants who will do the Ladakhi cultural dance, and we are going to set. We have set the Guinness World Record last year, and we still back the title this year. So this is indeed a huge platform and opportunity for each and everyone to celebrate Ladakh, and also, of course, to celebrate Union Territory status, which was granted recently.
Bringing forth the cultural vibrancy of Ladakh to center stage, the Naropa festival is significant in reminding the youngsters about their ancestral legacy and makes them feel proud of their rich heritage.
Naropa, to whom the festival is dedicated, is said to have become monk in Buddhist studies at the age of 25. He then joined the faculty of the great Nalanda University, where he became one of the four principals. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.